Hey, what's up, everyone? Welcome back to an episode of the Venom Vlog, and this is actually going to be a Spider-Man-centric episode because we have been kind of covering the Nick Spencer stuff from time to time, and with it coming to a close pretty soon and setting up the new Ben Reilly arc, because Ben Reilly is going to be coming back and being the new Spider-Man, or being Spider-Man again, I should say. So I'm really kind of pumped for that, and there's just been a lot of stuff. Like, the Nick Spencer stuff seems like he's trying to retcon the One More Day storyline, where Peter Parker and Mary Jane make a deal with Mephisto to kind of undo their love and undo their marriage, and in exchange everyone would forget that Peter Parker was Spider-Man, which would then bring Aunt May back to life, because she had died around that time. And it's a story that's very controversial. A lot of people don't really like that story. I personally am not a fan of One More Day, but for now, like for this episode, I wanted to kind of wrap up Nick Spencer's run. We still have one more issue left to go, but in this episode, I'm going to kind of go over King's Ransom, Chameleon Conspiracy, and then also the Sinister War stuff. But I mainly want to just talk about the retcons. Holy crap, the retcons. Nick Spencer has a ton of them here. So again, this is another episode where I don't have any digital codes to give away, because I've been buying this book digitally, but I will be collecting it in physical copy once Ben Reilly takes over the mantle of Spider-Man, starting with Amazing Spider-Man issue 75. So starting then, I will get into it. And we will make one more video focusing on Amazing Spider-Man 74 when that episode drops, so we can wrap out the Nick Spencer stuff. Because overall, I've kind of liked this run. It's had some misses for sure, but I like what Nick Spencer's done. But this is like unprecedented. So we'll start with King's Ransom. That was the first story, issue 61 to like 65-ish. And that one I'll sum up really quickly. Basically, the storyline that they've been building with Kingpin questioning, Kindred, Norman Osborn turning good, or at least his sins have been taken away. So he's trying to, take care of Kindred, make sure he doesn't get too hurt by Kingpin and what Kingpin wants, which is these tablets, that if he uses these tablets, he can basically resurrect his wife. And he went to Kindred at one point to do this, and Kindred turned him down. So Kingpin has now captured Kindred and has found these tablets and uses Spider-Man and Boomerang to track down the final tablet to put them together and make a wish come true. And he wants to bring back his wife. So in this, we have Boomerang kind of betraying Spider-Man and feeling bad about it. So he actually gives the tablet to Kingpin and now becomes very famous or infamous among the other rogues, the other villains out there. And they're all cheering that he did this and that he got the one up on Spider-Man, which a lot of them have never had the chance to do. And Boomerang did it. But he feels bad because obviously he liked being Peter Parker's roommate, and he's grown to like Spider-Man in a way. And so he feels bad about this. But while he's dwelling in that, and we'll talk more about that here in a little bit, Kingpin gets the chance to make his wish, and he decides at the last minute, you know what, Kindred was right. My wife would not like to be brought back during all this. She would not like me resurrecting her like this. She would not be happy to be with me again if she was brought back. And I'm going to do the next best thing. I'm going to put her soul to rest. Because before she died, she killed their son out of a loyalty allegiance towards Kingpin, kind of a messed up allegiance to him, I guess, or love for him. She took out their son, the Rose. And so what Kingpin does is he resurrects the Rose instead. That way her soul hopefully can go to rest knowing that she didn't kill their child or their son. So that was kind of neat, kind of a twist I didn't see coming. So now the Rose is back in the Marvel Universe for them to tell Rose stories if they want to. So that's one kind of retcon that they do here, and one that I think kind of makes sense. And then we'll talk more about Kingpin and kind of his role in Ravencroft. We'll get into that, in the next episode for sure, because we're covering the Ravencroft stuff. But then in Chameleon Conspiracy, we actually have the Chameleon come back in and do more retconning. So one thing Chip Zdarsky did when he was taking over Spider-Man books for a while was he introduced a sister to Peter Parker, someone who was born, same parents as Peter Parker had. And so that was something that a lot of people were like, oh God, that's so dumb. Why are they doing this? I personally don't like when they bring sibling characters out of nowhere in comic books. I never liked it back when they did it in the early days, and I don't really like it a lot modern day. And because there's just so much history with these characters, to introduce a sibling at this point is just like, oh my God, come on. So what I liked is that there is an explanation for it, finally. And after all these years, we've had the sister character running around saying she's Peter Parker's sister. She's actually not. It looks like that she is actually a chameleon. And that, much like Black Widow in the movie universe, where they say there's a bunch of different Black Widows that got trained and kidnapped as kids or whatever, it appears there's a similar program for chameleons in the Spider-Man universe here. So there have been chameleons. Obviously, there's Dimitri, the main chameleon that we all know and stuff from the comics, but there have been many other chameleons, and they've been kind of sleeper agents around the country, ready to spring into action. And I don't know why, for some reason, they chose Peter Parker's parents, because I guess they were normal people, then became spies, and then they, you know, left their son in the hands of, you know, Ben and May Parker, and they went off to do spy stuff, I guess, and then got killed at some point. So that's, I guess that's why there was a need to like make it seem like they had a kid at one point that wasn't Peter, to infiltrate any, you know, to maybe get into the information they uncovered at some point by being spies. I don't know. I guess that's the thought process there. But again, you know, she was like, wait a minute, Nick Fury handed me a photo once proving to me that I was actually, you know, the sister of Peter Parker. And then the chameleon says, are you sure Nick Fury handed you that photo? Again, revealing that maybe it was Chameleon as Nick Fury that handed her the photo. So just really neat. I kind of like that they retcon that, because again, I wasn't a big fan of it, but they don't retcon her. That's the thing, is like, I think Donny Cates was like, I'm going to retcon Eddie's sister and just say that she never existed and then not touch on it ever again beyond that. Whereas Nick Spencer devotes a whole arc explaining that, okay, she may not be Peter Parker's actual sister, even though they went out of their way to say she was at one point. So he's delicately says, she's not his sister, and here's what she really is, but we're not going to get rid of her as a character. She still has a role to play. And so there's this like world dominating device that, you know, Peter gets his hands on, and he's like, you know what? I don't know who to trust with this. I don't want it. So I'm going to give it to my sister, and hopefully she can put it in safe hands, her being a spy and everything like our parents were. And she doesn't reveal that she's actually a chameleon, but she does make the right decision. She says, you know, I don't care what Chameleon said of who I really am, that I'm a sleeper agent that got too deep undercover and now I believe who I really am. I don't care. I'm going to do the right thing and be a good person, because Peter Parker's a good person and because his parents were good people. So she takes that device and destroys it and does the right thing. So I kind of like that. Again, he's takes the continuity that has been handed to him as a Spider-Man writer, and he's like, all right, we're going to retcon this, but I'm not going to say none of it happened. I'm going to explain why it happened the way it happened. And I like that. So again, just, you know, showing that he's putting the effort in. So that sets up Sinister War. And I can breeze through this pretty quickly, because all I'll say about Sinister War is that you have different groups of Sinister Sixes. You have like the Superior Six or whatever, the Savage Six. You have the Sinister Six. You know, you have all these different versions of six villains. There's an all-female Sinister Six type group that's out there, with White Rabbit and stuff, and I think the female Dr. Octopus. So there's all these different versions of six villains that are all coming to fight Spider-Man, including Boomerang, who gets recruited in with some other, like, you know, superior villains from the Nick Spencer days when he wrote Superior Foes of Spider-Man, which was a great book, by the way. And so you have them, you know, him being recruited in and him feeling bad. He's like, you know what? I betrayed Spider-Man, and now, like, you know, 24 villains or whatever. There's six groups of six, I think, by the end of this. So 36 villains attacking Spider-Man all at once. You got the Foreigner in there, all these different villains from different time periods and eras of Spider-Man comics. And they're all attacking Spider-Man. And that's pretty much what the book is. It's Spider-Man trying to survive against all these villains while some of them betray Kindred. So they're all working for Kindred. He puts one of his worms inside all of their heads. And he's basically saying, if you don't do what I say, I'm going to kill you. And that leads into Dr. Octopus going, okay, well, I'm no man's puppet. And so I don't care who this Kindred is. If anyone's going to kill Spider-Man, it's me. I said this and done this before, where I wouldn't let, you know, Red Goblin kill Peter Parker. I'm not going to let Kindred kill Peter Parker. So I'm going to find a way to reverse, you know, the damage these worms are doing to us. So Doc Ock is working on that. Boomerang is feeling a little bad about, you know, working or betraying Spider-Man. So he actually helps Spider-Man at one point, putting his own life at risk. In fact, to the point where he does actually get killed. So there is a death in this one, and it's Boomerang. And that's some closure there for that story, but it really sucked, because I was like, man, he was actually doing the right thing. He was becoming the person that Peter and Spider-Man believed he could be. And he finally did at the end, and it cost him his life. So that was really tough. But again, the stakes being very high in this, which I like Nick Spencer keeps that going. But as Spider-Man's dying, I think at one point, you know, the Kraven's daughter stabs Peter Parker in the back, and he has to web himself up, you know, to seal the wound the best he can. But he's bleeding out and he's dying, and he ends up getting lured into, you know, face-to-face with Kindred, who up until this point had a face-to-face with Mary Jane. And at one point, Kindred took off his mask and revealed that he, you know, Kindred is actually Gwen Stacy. Turns out that's not true. I think that's something from the Chameleon Serum, saying to make him look like Gwen. But then Mary Jane says, "Wait, you're not Gwen. You're the Gwen's child. You're actually you know the child of Gwen Stacy. You and your brother Gabriel at one point." So then they get into that. So the retcons continue where Norman Osborn, you know, who's free of his sins, gets lured after Mendelstrom was killed. He was left in Mendelstrom's will, and this was all orchestrated by Kindred many, many years ago, back when it was still Harry Osborn, before the deal with Mephisto happened. So you still have Doctor Strange and Mephisto talking, and Doctor Strange trying to figure out what exactly happened to Peter Parker to where his life would be like this, you know, and all messed up like this. So we're building to something big. I can't wait to read the last issue here, because in this one, we get so many retcons in Sinister War. We find out that the shrink that Mary Jane talked to decades ago in the comic books, turns out that was actually Mysterio, all part of Kindred's plan. Like I said, the Chameleons, they revealed all that stuff. That was all part of Kindred's plan. You actually find out that Norman Osborn is not a father to any children from Gwen Stacy. That was a big twist, because that was another thing that made a lot of people repulsed, was why would Gwen ever sleep with Norman Osborn? And no matter how J. Michael Straczynski and Marvel tried to write that and make it work, it didn't. It made it really gross. It really crossed way too many lines. So this book undoes that. It says that Norman was actually being fed pheromones in their house by Mysterio, and, you know, and brainwashing by Chameleon, and working with Harry Osborn, who was trying to get back at his dad for all these terrible things that he's done, including Gwen's death. And he's like, no, like, you know, my father needs to be punished just like Peter does. They're responsible for Gwen's death and all the other horrible things that have happened to my friends in high school and college and all that stuff. So he's always had this plan to get back at them. And then I guess at some point with the deal with Mephisto that Peter and Mary Jane made, it kind of made Kindred go away or go to hell or something. And now he's fought his way back into the real world. I'm guessing, this is all my theories, but you have this incredible story where now Norman is not the father of Gabriel and his sister. You actually have that they've been genetically created, and that Harry retried creating them over and over and over, and fed this lie through brainwashing into Norman's head that he actually seduced Gwen Stacy. And I mean, granted, it still doesn't make all those stories right. You know, you still feel icky, and we certainly still felt icky reading them at the time. But this is definitely like Nick Spencer and whatever editors approved this coming in and going, you know what? Here's all the things we still get hate mail about nowadays. Let's just address it all and finding a way to do it. And yeah, some of it's wrapped up a little too neatly and a little too cleanly, and some of it's really sloppy the way Nick Spencer does it. But I think, at least I feel as a Spider-Man fan, this weight coming off. Like, oh my God, all these stories that I really just really never got into and couldn't justify or keep in my collection because I didn't like them and I want to just forget them. This whole story is basically clearing, you know, that the cobwebs out of those stories and making them still a part of the continuity. They still happen technically, but now there's reasons for why they happened. And so that's why I kind of don't mind these retcons. I mean, like I said, some are sloppy, some are done well. And we're going to all agree or disagree on the different versions of them or different ones that are retconned. But in the end, I'm glad the twins were taken out of continuity as far as them being actual biological twins of Gwen Stacy and Norman. I'm glad that's done. And it seems like we're building up to possibly the deal with Mephisto being broken in some way. But it also seems like Mephisto made a deal with Norman Osborn at one point, and that's why Harry is like this. Harry reveals, or Kindred reveals, that at one point Norman was down on his luck and was going to lose it all. And he made a deal with Mephisto, and all he had to give up was his firstborn son, which was Harry. And that seems to be why Harry is part of this whole deal, this whole Kindred thing, is why he got involved. And that's when he found out that that was what, you know, Norman got Gwen killed, and so did Peter. And now that, you know, Peter's made a deal that kind of undid stuff in their history, and then also Norman made a deal with Mephisto that, you know, cost Harry his soul, basically. That's why Harry is trying to get back at everybody. So I'm sure there's still more twists and turns to come in the last one, and probably some more retcons. But just the fact that they talked about the shrink that, you know, that Mary Jane talked to all those years ago, the fact that they brought up the twins and are undoing that, like, there's just so much in this. Even Mysterio, there's a whole issue dedicated to him talking about when he died in the pages of Daredevil, how he got resurrected. There's all, I mean, everything, how he got involved with Kindred, how he met Kindred in hell, basically. Like all that stuff is all planned out and dissected and fleshed out like in these pages. And while that's all being explained in expositional ways, you have this insane battle with Spider-Man and all of his foes fighting each other. And then in the end, Doc Ock turns the screws back on Kindred, rewires the worms, causes them all to drop dead, and then all the villains pass out, leaving just Doc Ock standing. And he tells Peter, "Look, like I said, if anyone's going to kill you, it's going to be me. But it's certainly not going to be this freak who just came into our lives and says he's been puppeteering stuff ever since the beginning. I'm a man of my own destiny, and I choose to do things when I want to do them, and no one pushed me to do anything." And he goes, "So go in there and take him down." Basically, Doc Ock does something good for Peter again. And Peter's like, he's like, "You're a good person, Doc." He's like, "I know you fight it all the time, but." He's like, "Thank you for helping me." So then Peter goes in to confront Kindred for the final time, with, I guess, Mary Jane is still in there after she got all of her answers. And we're going to see what happens and how Norman gets into this. And we're going to see the conclusion of it in Amazing Spider-Man number 74, which will be coming out soon. So I'm curious. We got one issue left. It's a $10 comic, Amazing Spider-Man number 74. It's a $10 comic. So I will buy it, and we will definitely make an in-depth breakdown of that issue, because I imagine it's going to cover a lot. I mean, there's still some threads unanswered here, but I think we're going to get all the answers from Nick Spencer's point of view, at least. And he's going to try to button this up probably the best he can while also setting up what comes next, which is Ben Reilly. And I will do a history of Ben Reilly and Kane coming up very soon, a part two of that, so we can catch you all up on how Ben Reilly came back from the dead, what he's been doing since he's been back, and also what Kane's role is now that Ben is back. Is he still the Scarlet Spider? Is he not? What's going on there? We're going to get into all that coming up very soon. And let me know what you think of all these retcons. Do you agree with me? Do you not agree with me? Do you just hate retcons in general? Do you like it when it's done this way? Do you like it when it's done the way Donny Cates did it? Whatever it is, let me know down below, and we'll talk about that as well. Thanks so much for watching the show. Like, share, subscribe, all that fun stuff, and I'll see you all in the future. Peace.